So the next important topic, and probably the most important topic, is the counters. Right? There are a lot of misconceptions about counters, and so therefore let us go through this very, very carefully. Okay? What is a counter? A counter is essentially characterized by something called a state transition diagram. Right? Now, so this counter has got state number 1, state number 2, state number 3, etc., up to state number k, and after state number k, it is going back to state number 1. So that is what this counter is doing, and all these states are distinct. So state 1 and state 2 and state 3 are all distinct states. Okay, now if you have a flip, normally these states will be implemented as a bunch of flip flops, as you already know. So there's a counter which has got outputs Q0, Q1, Q2 and so on, and we name this so that Q0 we treat as an LSB, Q1 as the next higher bit and so on, just some conventions. So this state is some particular combination of Q0, Q1, Q2. This next state is some other combination of Q0, Q1, Q2 and so on. Right? Now note that this Q2 is not necessarily a subsequent state. Right? For example, if this is 0,0, this need not be 0,0,1, this could be 1,0,1. If this is 101, this need not be 110, this could be 011 or whatever, right. So these states are actually not necessarily next to each other in terms of decimal numbers, right. They could be just arbitrary. The important thing is that they are different from each other. So the state 1 is different than state 2 is different than state 3 and so on. So that is very important. And such a counter is, which has got k states, is called a modulo k counter. And that is what is written over here. The counter k, counter with k states is called a modulo k or mod k counter. Okay. Now that is what this counter is, and there is some other box here called the decoding logic, and let us see what that does. Okay. A counter can be made with flip flops, as we said, each flip flop serving as a memory element with two states, 0 or 1. If there are n flip flops in a counter, right, there are 2 raised to n possible states, distinct possible states, since each flip flop can have either q equal to 0 or q equal to 1. So therefore, with n flip flops, it is possible to exclude, we can actually make a counter with, which is mod 2 raised to n, but it is also possible to exclude some of these states. Right? So suppose we have 3 flip flops, then the number of possible states is 8. From that, we can either make a mod 8 counter or mod 7 counter or mod 6 counter and so on. But of course, we cannot make a mod 9 counter from that. Okay? So that is what is being said here. So with n flip flops, we can make a mod k counter with k less than or equal to 2 raised to n. For example, if you have 4 flip flops, you can make a binary counter which counts from 0 to 1 to 2 to 15 and then back to 0. Or you can make a decimal counter which counts from 0 to 1 to 2 to 9 and then back to 0. Right? So in the first case, we have used 2 raised to n states. In the second case, we have used less than 2 raised to n states. Okay. Typically, a reset facility is also provided, which can be used to force a certain state to initialize the counter. And that is what we have shown over here. Okay, so what is this decoding logic? Let us see, let us take a look at that in detail. If you cannot read this, let me read it out for you. This is saying counter, and this is saying decoding counter, decoding logic. And this diagram is of course the same as before. So here is an example of the decoding logic. For example, this counter outputs, this example we have. State number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 and then back to 1. So this is a mod 8 counter, and we have some output which looks like this, which is 1 here in state number 3 and again 1 in state number 3. So this is what this decoding logic does. So this decoding logic can be used to take these flip-flop outputs as the input and produce a suitable pulse. For example, here we have a pulse which goes high in the third state only, and it's off otherwise. Right? So that is what the decoding logic does. So decoding logic will help you to, for example, you want to know which state the counter is in. you can construct an appropriate decoding logic here, and that will give you a suitable pulse which will tell you the state of that counter. Okay, so very often we don't talk about this decoding logic, but it is good to inform the students that such a thing is there. It's useful in actual systems. A binary ripple counter is something that we are all familiar with as the first counter that we study. Okay, so here again, it's always good to draw a concrete waveforms here and explain this. So in this case, J and K are tied to 1 for each one of these flip flops, and a clock is fed to the first flip flop, and the clock of the second one is actually derived from the Q0, the output of the first flip flop, and the clock of the last flip flop is from the output of the previous one, and so on. So now, because J and K is always 1 for this flip flop, and the clock is directly applied here, the output of this flip flop does not really depend on what these are doing, and therefore that is something we can draw immediately, and that is what is shown over here. So this is something that we can draw irrespective of what is happening to the other two flip flops. Now this is serving as a clock to the second flip flop, and therefore we can proceed and draw this one irrespective of what is happening to the last flip flop. So that is what we do here, and then this is serving as a clock to the last flip flop, and therefore we can proceed and draw that output. Okay, so that is, why is it called an up counter? Because if you look at Q2, Q1, Q0, you have 0, 0, 1, then 0, 0, 1, and 0, 1, 0, and 0, 1, 1, etc. And then after 1, 1, 1, it is back to 0, 0, 0. That is why it is essentially, if you look at decimal numbers, it is counting from 0 to 1 to 2 to 3, all the way up to 8, and then back to 0. Not 8, 7. 7 and then back to 0. So it is a modulo 8 counter with 8 distinct states. That is called binary because the sequence is binary. It is called ripple because the clock actually ripples through these flip flops, right? Because the clock is not connected to all of these flip flops, but the clock of the second one comes from the output of the first, the clock of the third one comes from the output of the second, and so on. That is why, the in a way, the clock ripples through all of these flip flops. That is why it is called a ripple counter. Okay, so this is the actual Q2, Q1, Q0 diagram. Now, important to point out that the direct inputs SD and RD, which are not shown, are assumed to be inactive. That means SD and RD are assumed to be 0 for all flip flops, allowing normal operation of the flip flops. Okay, a binary ripple counter. This is continued. So the counter has 8 states. 0, 0, 0 all the way to 1, 1, 1, and it is a mod 8 counter. So it is important to connect this picture with the previous picture which we had, in which we had this circle with various states and repetition after a certain state and so on, and then actually explicitly state why this is a mod 8 up counter. Okay, it is, there are some other names, and sometimes it is confusing for students who are looking at it for the first time. If the clock frequency is FC, for example, the frequency at the Q0, Q1, Q2 outputs is FC by 2. You can see that here, right? If this frequency is FC, this is FC by 2, this is FC by 4, and this is FC by 8, right, respectively. So for this counter, therefore, the divide by 2, divide by 4, and divide by 8 outputs are already available without requiring any decoding logic. If that was not the case and you wanted an FC by 2 operation, then you would have to construct some decoding logic which will give you pulses of this kind. Okay, so that is, so this divide by K divide by whatever number, that has to do with how the frequency of the clock is getting divided. Right? So here you see that, and it does not matter what the waveform actually looks like, it just depends on what the frequency is. Okay. Now this is the same as the previous circuit, except we have replaced the clock with positive edge trigger clocks, and that actually makes a big change because now it becomes a down counter. Now after 0, 0, 0, the first state that we have is 1, 1, 1, and the next one is 1, 1, 0, and so on, and therefore this becomes a down counter. We can go through all of these figures later. It's I'm sure all of you are familiar with this. It is straightforward. So homework, sketch the waveforms. Homework for the students, not for you. Sketch the waveforms and tabulate the counter states in each case. So here we have actually pretty similar configurations, except the clock here is now being derived from Q bar of the previous stage. Okay. And the difference between these two, the top and bottom, is that this is a positive edge triggered flip flop here. This is a negative edge triggered flip flop. And you will see that one of them is an up counter, the other one is a down counter, and so on. So give these problems to your students and do that. Ask them to do that. Okay, up down binary counters. So you can, since we already know what an up counter looks like, what a down counter looks like, you can make an up down binary ripple counter by providing a mode input that is shown over here, right? And so essentially all you need to check is whether the Q is going to the next flip flop as a clock, or Q bar is going to the next flip flop as a clock. In one case it will be an up counter, the other case it will be a down counter. All these waveforms etc. are given here. So you can figure this out. When mode is 1, the counter counts up, otherwise it counts down. And these things actually, let me just show this ready-made circuits to you. Okay, so there are some ready-made circuit files here that you can use. And in fact, you can even show these in class, you know, just to demonstrate to the students that these actually the outputs will be as expected as they have worked out. So there is a file called E101 counter 3. Okay, so here is a counter. Okay, so it's exactly the same circuit that we had in the slide. So we have a mode input here. That mode input is going to all of these top gates. There's a mode bar which is going to these bottom gates. So if mode is 1, then this Q is getting connected to clock here, this Q is getting connected to the clock here, and so on. If and this bottom gate then will just produce 0, right. If mode bar is 1, then this Q bar is getting connected to clock here, Q bar here is getting connected to clock here, and so on. Alright, so let us run this, let us see what mode is right now. Okay, right now the mode value is 0, so that means it should do, these are, this will, it will depend on whether these are positive edge triggered or negative. Let's run it and see what it does. Okay, so this is the output, this is the clock, this is the Q0, this is the Q1, this is the Q2, and you can clearly see the frequency division, right. The frequency here is some FC, this is FC by 2, FC by 4, FC by 8. So you have this divide by 2, divide by 4, divide by 8 counters readily available in a binary counter, without constructing any decoding logic. Okay, let's change the mode value now and see what happens. Let's look at this waveforms again. So it's counting down right now, right? 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1, then 1, 1, 0, then 1, 0, 1, and so on. Back to, let's see, this is back to 0, 0, 0. So here we have 0, 0, 0, and then back to 1, 1, 1. So it is counting down. So if you change the mode input, you will see that it counts up. So let's make the mode input 1 and run the program again. Yeah, so now it is counting up, right. So let's compare these two. Okay, here after 0 0 0 the next state was 1 1 1. Here after 0 0 the next state is 0 0 1. After that 0, 1, 0, and so on. So this one is counting up, the right one, the left one is counting down. So you can actually show these demonstrations to students in class, and convince them that these circuits will actually work as you discuss in class. So let's continue with counters. There are some other types of counters we want to see now. All right. So we have discussed these direct inputs to flip-flops, and in particular the set direct and reset direct. These can be used actually to control the sequence of the counter. For example, here in this example, what we have is we have a binary counter, but when the counter reaches a certain stage, we have taken some of these inputs, some of the outputs of the counter, and use that to reset these flip-flops. Okay. So as a result, what happens is when this counter reaches a certain stage, the reset input becomes active, and that clears all the flip-flops. So this waveform you may not be able to see too well. So let's actually see this SQL example, and you will be able to see the waveforms more clearly. So let me share the desktop. All right, so the example I was talking about is also there in this distribution, B101 counter 5. Yeah. All right, so what I hope you can see this very clearly. So what we are doing here is this one is just the digital, the logical level one. So that one is connected to J and K here. That one is also connected to J and K here. So all of these flip-flops are actually getting this one here, right? Then there is a zero. This zero is the logical zero, and that is connected to the set input of all of these. Right? So the set input is inactive for all of these things. The reset input is actually coming from this gate, right? And this gate is getting its input from Q1, and it is getting it from Q3. So when the flip-flop reaches the state, when the counter reaches the state 1, 0, 1, 0, that is the time this flip-flop will force all of these, gate will force all of these flip-flops to get reset to 0, 0, 0, 0. So after the state 1001, the next state 1010 will not be allowed by this gate. So let us look at these results and see that it actually happens. Okay, so here it is. So this is 0000 followed by 0001 and so on, and all the way up to 1000, then 1001. So that is decimal 9, right? So after decimal 9, what is happening is, if you look at this, let's expand this part. After decimal 9, what is happening is this: there is a reset pulse getting created. Maybe let me expand it further, so you can see it carefully. Okay, so there is a small reset pulse that is being produced by the gate, and that is serving to reset all of these flip-flops back to 0000, and then the counter starts again counting up. So that is how this works. Okay, suppose we connect, instead of Q3 here, let me connect something else, and see, let us see what happens. And these are good things to do in class so that the students develop a better understanding of this whole thing. So let me, instead of Q3, let me connect Q2 here, right? And I need to make some changes here. Okay, so what I have done is I have connected, now instead of Q3, I have connected Q2 and Q1 to this gate. So what will happen now? When the counter reaches the state 0110, that will not be allowed by this gate anymore, and immediately it will clear all of these flip-flops, right? So let us see if that happens. So let's run this. I need to just make a small change here. Okay, let's run this now. That was the previous one. Let's plot the new one. Okay, so let us see what is happening now. So we are starting with 0, 0, 0, 0 once again. Then the next one, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0 has come. Then 0, 1, 0, 1. Right? After that, we get 0, 1, 1, 0. But then that is clearing all of these flip flops. Right? So that state is not allowed, not being allowed by this reset pulse. And that is essentially clearing all the flip-flops. So that is the pulse that is being produced here. That serves to reset everything. Okay. So that's a small change you can actually make and demonstrate in class, and that explains the functioning of this circuit. How do you get back to the A view? Okay, so that is how a decade counter works. In fact, this is called decade only because it counts from 0 to 9 and then back to 0. And you can make it count similarly from 0 to 5 and back to 0 and so on. And that's what we have just done. Okay, so let's go ahead to the next counter, a synchronous counter. So in a synchronous counter, what happens is the clock goes to all of these clock inputs. And in this case, these AND gates are serving to connect Q0 of this to J and K of this one. Right? And so therefore, let us see what it does. Let's just look at the waveforms. Okay. So J0 and K0 are both equal to 1. Okay, J1 and K1 is equal to Q0 here. J2 and K2 is Q1 and Q0, J3 and K3 is Q2, Q1, Q0, right? And so therefore, the second flip flop will change only when Q0 becomes 1. Right? The third flip flop will change only when Q1, Q0 become 1, and so on. So that is how this works. It's called synchronous because the same clock is now going to all four flip flops. Okay, the first output of course does not depend on any of these following flip flops, so that we can draw immediately as soon as the clock is given, because the J and K for that flip flop are always 1. Next one, now we need to see when Q0 is 1, right? So now the second active edge comes, Q0 has been 1, so that serves as the J and K for this one. So at this point, this Q1 will toggle. So then you can construct Q1. Similarly, when Q1 and Q0 are both 1, that is when this J and K are both 1, and that is when this flip flop will toggle. Okay. So that is what is happening there, and so on. So this is again a binary up counter, but it is a synchronous counter. It is remember in the binary ripple counter we had the Q of this going to the clock of this one, and so on. Here we are not doing that. Here the clock is going to all of these counters, all of these flip flops. Okay. Now we will consider the reverse problem, that is we are given a particular sequence of states and we want to design a synchronous counter which will actually perform that job, that is it will go through those states that we specify. Okay. Now for that, let us get back to the whiteboard and see how that can be done. So that and we will assume that we are using JK flip-flops. So this is the table for a JK flip-flop. If J is 0, K is 1, Q n plus 1 is 0, same as Qn, Qn bar. Okay. All right. So now what we want to do is we want to look at the reverse problem. This table is useful, the one that we are drawing now is useful if you know what J and K are and if you want to predict the next state. Now we want to look at the reverse problem. The reverse problem is like this. So given Qn and Qn plus 1, what values of J and K will make this possible? Okay, so that is the reverse problem that we want to consider. So let us make another table here. So here we say Qn plus 1 J and K. So let's say our Qn before the clock transition came, the active clock edge came, was 0, and the next one we would also like it to be 0. Okay. And what values of J and K will make this possible? That is the question. Right. So now let's go back to this table. Right. So we can get 0 if J is 0 and K is 1, right? J is 0, K is 1. That is one possibility. The other possibility is to use this entry, right? And that is because Qn, remember Qn plus 1 and Qn are actually the same. So Qn plus 1 is the same as Qn in this case, and therefore we can even use this table. And what is that entry? That is J is equal to 0, K equal to 0, right? So these are the two sets of values for J and K, which will allow Qn to go from 0 to 0. Right. So in other words, since K is not mattering here, we have J equal to 0 and K equal to X. So K really does not matter whether it is 0 or 1, and both of these are allowing this to be achieved. Next, we will consider Qn equal to 0 and Qn plus 1 equal to 1. So, if Qn plus 1 is equal to 1, we can either use this entry here. That means J is equal to 1, K equal to 0, or we can use, note that this is toggling, right, or we can use this entry, right. So, we can use either that, the first one, or J equal to 1, K equal to 1. Now, if you look at these together, J must be 1 and K does not matter what it is. So, J equal to 1 and K is X. Next, we will look at Qn equal to 1 and Qn plus 1 equal to 0. So, how can that be achieved? That can be achieved by either this entry here, which is J equal to 0, K equal to 1, or it is again toggling, or this entry here. Right? So, that is J equal to 1, K equal to 1. So, if you look at this, K must be equal to 1 and J can be either 0 or 1, or that is X. How about 1, 1? If Qn is 1, was 1, and Qn plus 1 is supposed to be 1, then we can either use this entry, which is J equal to 1, K equal to 0, or we can use this entry here, because your Qn value is, Qn plus 1 is the same as Qn here. So, we can use J equal to 0, K equal to 0 as well. Again, if you look at these two together, what we are getting is J equal to K equal to 0 and J equal to X. Right? J does not matter, 1 and 0. All right. So this is the reverse table which we can use in designing a counter. Right? This is the table that we use to analyze a counter, and the second table we use for designing a counter. So let us see how that can be done. Of course, we are only talking about synchronous counters now. Okay, so this slide essentially says what we have just discussed, and it completes, it fills up this table. And of course, the for all of this to happen, you need a clock active edge, and that is what is shown in this column here. Okay, so here is an example. So the example has got, so the counter that we are supposed to design has got 5 states, 0, maybe I will do this also on this paper so that you can see properly. Okay. So let me just reproduce this problem on this paper. So it is like this, we are given states, there are 5 distinct states, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and after that the counter repeats. So we are back to state number 1 and 2 and so on. The Q2, Q1, Q0 values are given. We are going to use JK flip-flops. The first state is given as 0, 0, 0. Next state is given as 0, 0, 1. Then after that is 0, 1, 0. After that is 0, 1, 1. Then 1, 0, 0. And then 0, 0, 0 again. And then it repeats. So we don't need to really reproduce the sequence again, we just say repeats over here. Alright, so now let us see how to do this systematically. For this purpose, we need to reproduce the table that we have just discussed in the previous slide, and that is given Qn and Qn plus 1, what are J and K. So let me reproduce that paper, that table here, and based on that we can design this counter. So we have already seen this. Okay, so this is the table that we have for given Qn and Qn plus 1, what is J and K. So let's see how to do this. So first we see that the state is 0, 0, 0, and Q2 is changing from 0 to 0, right. So what should J2 be at that point, J2 and K2, that we can look up from this table. So Q2 is going from 0 to 0, so therefore J2 and K2 can be 0 and X, must be 0 and X, right. Okay, Q1 is going from 0 to 0. So J1, K1 must also be 0 and X. Q0 is going from 0 to 1. Therefore, sorry, J0, K0 should be 0 to 1. Let's look at this table here, 1X. Okay. So that is how we can complete this table. Okay, this, let us quickly do this and then we can. Or let me just do one more entry and then we can just go back to slides and I will show the completed table. 0, 0, so we have, so the next state now, we have 0, 0, so this goes from, this becomes 0x, 0 to 1, that is 1x, this goes from 1 to 0, so that is x and 1 and so on. So we proceed this, proceed in this manner all the way up to this entry. And then after that, of course, after we cover this transition, then we don't need to do anything further, because then the counter will not enter in any other state, but same cycle will continue. Okay. So that is what we get for, that is how we complete this table for J's, the various J's and K's. Okay. So let's go back to the document and see the completed table. Okay, so this is what is showing. That table filling process, okay, one by one, right. So that one by one is very important, and so of course it's a mechanical procedure once we understand what is being done. Okay, so now what we have is the truth tables for J0, K0, J1, K1, J2, K2 in terms of Q0, Q1 and Q2. So in fact, you notice that there are many entries which are not even there in this, right. So out of the eight possible combinations, we have only 5 possible combinations, and therefore states like 0, states like 1, 1, 1 for example is not here in this table. So what do we do about that state? For that state, we treat J2, K2, J1, K1, J0, K0 as don't cares, because our counter is never going to enter that state, and therefore those become don't care conditions for us. And in fact, we can use those to minimize our functions using corner maps. So that's what this comment says here. Note that we have not used note that we have not tabulated the J and K values for those combinations of Q0, Q1, Q2 which do not occur in the state transition table. For example, Q2, Q1, Q0 equal to 110. That does not appear. That does not appear in the state transition table, and therefore, we treat those conditions as don't care conditions. And that's all that is listed in the next slide. Okay, so I'm not sure if you can see this, reproduce this. Okay, so let me just give an example of J2 and K2. What we are now doing is J2 is a logical variable which is a function of Q2, Q1 and Q0. K2 is another logical variable which is a function of Q2, Q1, Q0 and so on. So we are going to minimize these functions with K maps. So let me just draw for you the K map for J2 and K2. And then you will get an idea of what we are talking about. So let's, I'll just reproduce, all this is there in the slide, so you can look it up later. So let's say this is the map for J2, this is the map for K2. Okay. If the students go through this exercise, they know not only sequential circuits but also corner maps. So that's good too. It serves as a good exercise for the students. Okay, so it turns out that this is 0, 0. X, 0, 1, X, X, 0, 1, X, X, 1, X, 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 X. Okay. Now, some of these X's are coming from the fact that the counter does not enter that particular state at all. For example, Q2, Q1 equal to 1, 1, Q0 equal to 1, 1 gives you this X, and this state is never occurring in the state transition diagram, and that is why we have put an X over here. Some of the other X's are actually because of the entries that we had in the previous slide. Okay. Anyway, so in this case, this one can be combined with this X here, and this will give you whatever J2 equal to Q1, Q0. Q1, Q0 bar, or Q1, Q0. Okay. Now, in case of K2, you have 1 here and all others are X's. And in fact, we can make all of these X's equal to 1 and we can just replace this whole thing by K2 equal to 1. So, here is an example, J2 equal to Q1, Q0, K2 equal to 1 should be applied to the flip flop 2 so that it will do the desired job. Okay, so that sort of completes our design procedure. We have J2, K2, J1, K1, J0, K0, the maps for all of those, and then the minimal expressions for all of these. So this is the summary. J2 is Q1, Q0, K2 is 1, J1 is K0, K1 is Q0, J0 is Q2 bar, K0 is 1. All that follows from the corner maps. So then we just make these connections. For example, J2. We said is K2 is Q1 Q0, right? So there is a Q1 here going to this gate. There is a Q0 which is going to this gate, and that output is going to J2, and so on. So you make all of these connections, and if you run this example, you will get the desired result. Let me see if I have a SQL circuit for this. So maybe I don't. Fine, but you can actually do this in with SQL and show that it actually works as desired. Okay, well, one final topic, and that is combination of counters. Right? And a good example of this is there is a commercial chip. I don't remember the name. It's a decade counter, and that is implemented as a divide by 2 and divide by 5 counters. Okay. So what is the combination of counters? We have two counters here, counter 1 which is mod K1, counter 2 which is mod K2, counter 1 is getting clock 1, counter 2 is getting clock 2. In general, the clock 1 and clock 2 can be independent, but in this case, we want to make these synchronous and see, let us see what we, how we can do that. So, consider two counters, counter 1 mod k1, counter 2 mod k2, and each of them can be a ripple or a synchronous type, that really does not matter. Okay. So, the type of these counters really does not matter in what in the discussion that is following. Since counter 1 has k1 states and counter 2 has k2 states, we can get a new counter with k1 times k2 states if appropriate synchronization is provided between the two clocks. There are two ways of doing it. One is derive clock 2 from clock 1 using some decoding logic if necessary. So, we this clock 2 we can derive from this counter, either clock 1 directly or we can use these outputs and derive clock 2 from there. Second output, second option is, so that is here, okay. So, there is a decoding logic. So, clock 1 is driving first counter, there is a decoding logic which is providing a clock 2 to the second counter. That is one option. Second option is to drive the two counters with the same clock, okay. That is what is done here. So, this is counter 1, this is counter 2 and we are now driving them with the same clock. In both cases you will get a counter which is, which has a modulo k1, k2, okay. So, here is an example, here is a mod 2 counter, just a single flip flop which is toggling between 0 and 1 with j 0 and k, with j and k equal to 1. Here is a mod 5 counter which we have just designed and that is going from 0 0 0 to whatever state and repeating after every 5 states. Now, we can combine this mod 2 and mod 5 counters to make a mod 10 counter, okay. And there are two options again like we said, option A in which the clock for the second counter is derived from the first, option B in the in which the a common clock is used to drive both of these counters. So, there are two, these are the two options possible. Okay, and here there are some results which are shown. This is approach A. Actually, this the results are sort of self-explanatory, and we will not really go through that. But you should take a more detailed look at this count, this example, and see what exactly is happening. Why you are getting instead of why you are getting 10 states now from this modulo 2 and modulo 5 counters, and what are those 10 states that you can actually make a table and see. This is approach B in which the same clock is connected now to both these counters, this is counter 1 and this is counter 2, and again you will get 10 different states, and after 10 states the count will repeat, and you should actually look at this in more detail and see what is the difference between approach A and approach B in terms of the waveforms. They are both equivalent in terms of the modulo number because the modulo number is 10 in both cases, but the details like what is Q2, Q1, Q0 and the fourth one will determine, will depend on what configuration you use. Alright, some example, some homework kind of problem, show that by connecting the Q bar output of the mod 2 counter to the clock input of the mod 5 counter, we get a decade counter counting up from 0000 to 1001. So, this is something that the students can actually do on paper and then verify their results with simulation. Okay, so I think that is the sort of end of this particular presentation, and this is more or less where we end our discussion on sequential circuits in our course E101, and then of course then there are advanced courses for digital system design, but that is not at the basic electronics level. So, I think the scope of this course essentially whatever we covered would be adequate. All right. So, now what we want to do is I just wanted to show you one 555 example, because after you cover sequential circuits, RS flip flop and so on, it is then good to cover the 555 timer, because by this time the students would have done RC circuits and op amps and comparators and so on, and then 555 is a good combination, is a good chip that you can take up at this point. So, let me just show you and anyway, then we will go to the next presentation where we want to cover, talk about RC circuits. All right, okay. Okay, so let me share the desktop. So this particular animation is available on the web, and just go to the SQL web page and you will find it over there. Okay, so there is an oscillator using 555. That's a good example to take up. All right. So unfortunately the font is a little too big here, and so you may not be able to see everything at the same time. But briefly what this does is, you can specify the values of RA and RB here and C, and then you can compute the waveforms first, and that computation is done here. The plots are shown here. Also the times T1 and T2, which are I think T1 is this and T2 is this time, that is computed, and the frequency of the clock, frequency of the output will be computed. And then we can actually start the animation and see, and you can use this animation to explain what is happening inside the 555 timer. But before we do that, let's just look at this plot. Okay. So what is this plot showing? This plot is, so this point is of course sitting at 2 VCC by 3, and this point is sitting at, this node is sitting at VCC by 3. And these comparators are simply comparing this common voltage VC with 2 VCC by 3 and VCC by 3. So that is what is being shown over here. So when the VC, the capacitor voltage, exceeds 2 VCC by 3, your reset input becomes 1 to the flip flop. And this goes, when this goes below VCC by 3, your set input becomes 1. And that is of course very crucial in understanding this particular circuit. That is why these things, this R and S plots are actually shown explicitly. So now let us see what happens when you start animation of this. Okay, so let me pause this at this point. So what is happening here right now is that the output is 0. Output is 0, the Q, therefore Q bar is 1. This switch is closed, and therefore this capacitor is now discharging through this path here. And that is what is being shown here. Okay, let's continue. Okay, now when you come to this point, right, what is happening is your capacitor voltage is falling just below VCC by 3, and your, therefore your S has become 1. R is still 0, and the output of Q of the flip flop is going from 0 to 1. If the output goes from 0 to 1, Q bar goes from 1 to 0, this switch opens, and all that is happening because this VC has fallen below VCC by 3. Okay, let's continue with the animation. Okay. Now the charging starts. Let me pause it. Okay, on this phase, the switch is open and the capacitor is now getting charged by VCC towards 5 volts, and that is what is shown over here. And during this time, note that R and S are both 0, and therefore the output that does not change, it remains 1 volt. Okay, let's continue. So this story continues up to this point at that transition, and this point now, what has happened is this switch has now closed and the capacitor has started discharging again. So you can actually show sort of when you teach 555 oscillator circuit, you can use this and show the students what is actually happening inside the 555 timer circuit. There is also another one on monostable. Yeah, there is also another applet on monostable using 555, that is generation of a single pulse, right. So it's very similar to the last one. Okay, so here again given these values of R and C, you can compute the pulse width, and it shows this graph here. Okay. Now in this case again, this node is sitting at 2 VCC by 3 and that is sitting at VCC by 3, but now they are being compared with different things. So this one is being compared with trigger, and this one is being compared with VCC. That is why we have shown this R and S separately. So the S input on the flip flop becomes 1 if the trigger goes below VCC by 3, and the R input goes 1 if the VC of the capacitor, the capacitor voltage goes above 2 VCC by 3. Okay, so that is, so there is a difference between the first circuit and this circuit. So then the animation is pretty similar. So let's continue. Let's start. So that is what happens there. During this time, when the trigger is high, when the trigger has not yet become active, the situation is that Q is 0, Q bar is 1, the switch is closed and the capacitor is directly connected to ground through the switch. And of course, the switch resistance is so small that all this discharging happens instantaneously. Okay, so let's continue and, okay, at this point we can pause. Now, at this point what has happened is, the trigger has become low. Okay, so therefore, this S is now going to become 1, because now we are going to go to this point, S is going to become 1, R is still 0, and that is going to set this flip flop from 0 to 1. If Q goes from 0 to 1, Q bar is going to go from 1 to 0, and this switch is going to open. If this switch opens, let us see what happens next. Okay, if this switch opens, then of course the capacitor now starts charging towards 5 volts, and this goes on until this point. And all this time, of course, your R and S are both 0. Okay, at this point, the VC has actually gone above, has gone beyond 2 VCC by 3, making R equal to 1, and S is still 0, and therefore this flip flop is now going to get reset from 1 to 0, and the switch, the Q bar is going to become 0 to 1, so the switch is going to close. All that is showing is shown in this figure, and we can continue. And of course, the rest of the story is already explained earlier, and so on. Okay. So these are applets that you can use in when you're teaching monostable and astable application of 555. Okay. So I think we can stop here, and maybe I can just take a couple of questions if there are, and then we can break for tea. Yeah, okay. The first question is, what is the difference between NAND latch and NOR latch? They are actually very similar. In fact, the first two entries in that table were the same as we saw. So R equal to 1, S equal to 0, and R equal to 0, S equal to 1 will give you the identical outputs. The difference is which of the states gives you the previous state. So in the NAND latch, R equal to 1, S equal to 1 gives you the previous state. In the NOR latch, R equal to 0, S equal to 0 gives you the previous state. And that, of course, is very easy to figure out from the configuration. And of course, the other, they also differ in which of the states is, which of the input combinations is not allowed. Okay. So in the NAND latch, R equal to 0, S equal to 0 is not allowed. In the NOR latch, R equal to 1, S equal to 1 is not allowed. So that's the answer to the first question. Jaychand, Rajendra College.
Hello sir, whatever circuit you are showing it on the screen, that is up down a binary ripple counter, in between two JK flip flops we can observe two AND gates and one OR. How can we derive it at that, sir? Is there any procedure?
Your question is not quite clear to me, how can you derive what is inside the JK flip flop? Is that what you are trying to say?
No sir, in between two flip flops there is two AND gate and one OR. How can we derive at that, sir, at that circuit?
Okay, you're talking about this particular circuit, right? The up down binary ripple counter. So this, the logic actually is very simple. Essentially what we want to do is we want to connect either Q as the clock here to the next stage, or we want to connect Q bar as the clock. So what we do is we create a mode signal, and then that mode is 1, and we create a mode bar signal. So if this mode is, the top gate gets a 1, then the bottom gate will get a 0. So let's just take the case where mode is 1, right? If the mode is 1, then the bottom gate will produce a 0 here, and that 0 OR, this is simply just putting these two together, and if this is 0, then this OR gate is actually not doing anything but passing this output to the clock. And what is the output of this one? the one gate, one input of this gate is 1. So the output of this gate is the same as this Q here, and that is being passed to the clock of the next gate. Okay. Similarly, if your mode is 0, then the output from Q bar here will get passed through these two gates to the clock of the next stage. Okay. So that is the logic. Actually is quite simple. In fact, you can just derive it using Carnot map or whatever. But it's so simple that you don't really need to use Carnot maps in this case. Amruta, Bangalore.
Hello. Good morning, sir. Sir, I have one question regarding whether ADC or shift register converts the spatial domain to a temporal domain.
Okay, the question is whether a shift register converts the spatial domain into a temporal domain. In a way, it does. Now, the example that we have shown, when we loaded some bits into a shift register in parallel, so you can think of that as being in space. So when we load, that is happening in space, for example. And then after that, when you actually shift these bits, that shift is, you can think of that as a temporal shift. So yeah, that interpretation is correct. Okay, so we'll take the rest of the questions after 12:30, since now we have a tea break. See you later.